Hello friends, today we will be discussing about the types of the thrombi. Already in my previous video I have finished about what is the pathogenesis of the thrombi. So today in this video we will be discussing about what are the types of the thrombi, what is the fate of the thrombus which is formed, and what is the difference between the antemortem and the postmortem clot. Now coming to the types of the thrombi, we have four types of the thrombi: arterial thrombi, venous thrombi, capillary thrombi and cardiac thrombi. We'll see each one of them. Now coming to the differences between arterial and the venous thrombi, everything is different, the pathogenesis, the morphology, we have certain differences. When we see the pathogenesis, arterial thrombi, it is mainly formed from the endothelial injury. If you remember the pathogenesis, the main causes, we have a Virchow triad where the cause of the thrombus formation is either by the endothelial injury, altered blood flow or hypercoagulability. So arterial thrombi, they are mainly formed because of the endothelial injury. Now this endothelial injury can be because of the turbulence of the blood flow. So normally, this also I have already discussed, normal blood flow is a laminar blood flow where you have the blood cells which are present in the central compartment and the plasma will be present in the outer compartment so that the cells doesn't come in contact with the endothelial cells. Now when you have the turbulence in the conditions where the blood is passing through the valves or the larger vessel when it is bifurcating, then also you have the turbulence. In such a conditions when you have a turbulence, there will be a disturbance of this laminar flow and the cells come in contact with the endothelial cells. Now because of the pressure or because of the cells coming in contact with the endothelial cells, these endothelial cells get damaged and that is one of the cause for the formation of the thrombi. Whereas when we see the venous thrombi, the main cause is stasis. In the stasis again we don't have the flow of the blood, so we don't have the laminar flow of the blood, instead we have just the stagnation of the blood with the cells. So these cells, they come in contact with the endothelial cells and the WBCs which come in contact with endothelial cells, they can cause damage to the endothelial cells by their reactive oxygen species whatever they are producing. Even these cells get activated when they come in contact with endothelial cells and release the reactive oxygen species. Similarly, the platelets, when they come in contact with the endothelial cells, they get activated. Now once they get activated, they degranulate and they release the ADPs which in turn activates the other platelets, and slowly there will be the platelet aggregation. So first we have the adhesion, then we have the platelet aggregation that leads to the formation of the thrombi. So main cause for the venous thrombi is stasis, whereas main cause for the arterial thrombi is endothelial injury due to the turbulence. And these arterial thrombi, they are formed in the rapidly flowing blood of arteries and the heart, whereas venous thrombi, they are formed in the slow flowing blood. Coming to the growth of the thrombi, the arterial thrombi, it grows retrogradely in the reverse direction of the flow of the blood. When we are seeing this, this is the aorta, abdominal aorta, where the blood is flowing in this direction, whereas the growth of the thrombi is in the reverse direction. Similarly, when we see the venous thrombi, it grows in the direction of the blood flow. Now when the blood is flowing in this direction, the growth will be in this direction. So whether the growth is in the reverse direction in the arterial thrombi or in the direction of the blood flow in the venous thrombi, both will be towards the heart, and the part which is propagating, that will be very friable and it will be weakly attached to the thrombi, so it can detach easily and this part can embolize also. Now coming to the sites, arterial thrombi, they are more common in the coronary arteries, cerebral and femoral arteries. So coronary arteries, if you see at the opening of the aorta, we have the coronary arteries. This is one of the commonest site, and the cerebral arteries, which are most, we see at the circle of the villus, we have anterior cerebral artery, middle cerebral artery and posterior cerebral artery. These are the other common site. Then another one is the femoral arteries, which is a branch of the common iliac artery. So these three are the most common sites for the arterial thrombi. But But when we see the venous thrombi, the common sites are the veins of the lower extremities. So it can be femoral vein or the saphenous vein or popliteal vein. So the veins of the lower extremities, they are the common sites for the venous thrombi, whereas other sites also are there, that is the veins of the upper extremity, periprostatic plexus or periuterine and ovarian plexus. These are also the sites where we can have the venous thrombi. Now coming to the morphology, when we see the gross features, the arterial thrombi will be gray-white, it will be friable, to form it will be with the lines of the sand. We see alternate red and the white lines, whereas the venous thrombi, it will be mostly red in color, red-blue with the fibrin strands. Now why we get these lines of the sand is, we have alternating layers of the platelets along with the fibrin. Now this forms one band. Platelets with the fibrin deposition, it forms one band, and to that alternately we have the RBCs, deposition of the RBCs, which appears as a darker band. So in that way we have alternate pale and the darker band. So microscopically when we see, we have in the arterial thrombi we have more prominent alternating pale platelet and fibrin deposition alternating with the darker RBC rich areas. Whereas when we see the venous thrombi, we have most of the bands, they are made up of the red cells. So we have abundant red cells which will be alternating with the fibrin strands. So this one, because more abundance of the RBCs, it appears more red in color, and hence it's also called as a red thrombi. Now composition, as we have seen, it's made up of the fibrin meshwork of the platelets, fibrin, red cells and degenerating leukocytes. Whereas the venous thrombi, it's mostly made up of the enmeshed RBCs. So arterial thrombi, it has very clear lines of the Zahn, darker areas and the lighter areas. Whereas venous thrombi, there may not be so prominent lighter areas. We see only the red color darker areas because of abundance of the RBCs in them. Coming to the effects of the thrombi, arterial thrombi usually doesn't cause occlusion in the initial stages. They are firmly attached to the muscle. They are usually mural, not occluding the lumen completely. But as they are growing, they can cause deficiency of the blood supply, which leads to ischemia, leading to the infarct. Whereas the venous thrombi, it has only the RBCs and it is usually occlusive. It grows to a larger size and it takes the cast of the vessel. And this, as they are very loosely attached to the vessel wall, they can detach and that leads to the embolism. So that what we call it as a thromboembolism. Now that was the differences between arterial and the venous thrombi. Now the other one what we have is the capillary thrombi. These are the thrombi which are formed in the small vessels, capillaries, and they are mainly formed by the RBCs, packed red cells, and usually we see them in the acute inflammatory lesions, in the vasculitis and in the DICs. Now the last one is about the cardiac thrombi. So as the name suggests, cardiac, we see the thrombi in the chambers of the heart or on the valve cusps. So most commonly in the heart chamber, we see in the atrial appendages, because in the ventricles and the atria, the muscle will be contracting and pushing off the blood. So there will be flow of the blood, whereas in the appendages, that much movement of the blood will not be there. So we have the stasis in the atrial appendages, which can lead to formation of the thrombi. And that usually, especially we see in the right atrial appendages. And also one of the common causes we see on the vegetations on the mitral and aortic valves. So vegetations, what they cause is the free movement of the valves is inhibited and there will be gushing of the blood. So that gushing of the blood will produce the turbulence. So that turbulence will damage the endothelium, leading to the formation of the thrombi. And they are also usually the mural, they are not occlusive. And in this, the two types which are to be mentioned are the ball valve thrombus is one, which we see usually in the left atrium. So here we have a large round thrombus will be present in the chamber of the heart. And when this chamber contracts, the thrombus moves and obstructs the valves. Whereas when it relaxes, it moves back and the valve opens. So this one we call it as a ball valve thrombus. And another one is agonal thrombi. This is mainly composed of the only the fibrinous material, and these are formed shortly before the death, and this can be seen in both the ventricles. So these are about the four types of the thrombi: arterial, venous, capillary and cardiac thrombi. Now what is the fate of the thrombus which is formed? So one of the important the thing what happens is there can be increase in the size of the thrombus, what we call it as propagation. So on the thrombus we have deposition of the more elements, more cells in the blood, like RBCs, leukocytes. They will be going on depositing on the thrombus which is formed. So the size of the thrombus will slowly increase. It will enlarge and it will occlude the vessel. So this increase in the size we call it as propagation. And another thing is it can undergo organization. Organization means here the leukocytes and the RBCs which are deposited in the thrombus, they will be eaten up by the macrophages and the neutrophils, and slowly we have the growth of the fibroblasts into them and endothelial cells, and these endothelial cells proliferate and they form the small vessels within the thrombus. So that we call it as organization, means development of the small capillaries with the fibroblastic proliferation, we call it as organization. Now, another fate is it can, the thrombus which is formed, it can detach from its site of attachment, and here the thrombus which is detached, it flows in the blood, which we call it as embolism, and then this emboli can block the vessels. Finally, it can undergo the resolution also. There can be, once a thrombus is formed, the body will react in its own way. It activates the fibrinolytic mechanism, so that can be lysed. There can be release of the plasmin which dissolves off the thrombus. So thrombus may disappear. So the four things what can happen is either it can propagate, it can organize, it can detach and form an emboli, or it can undergo the resolution. Now what's the difference between antemortem thrombi and a postmortem clot? So when we see the origin of the antemortem thrombi, we have seen that the cause is either it is hemostasis or it is because of the endothelial injury where we have the activation of the coagulation cascade. Whereas the postmortem clot, it is mainly because of the sedimentation of the clotted blood. And grossly when we see the antemortem thrombi, it is dry, granular, firm and friable. Whereas the postmortem clot, it is just gelatinous, soft and rubbery. And relation to the vessel wall, antemortem thrombi is adherent to the vessel wall, whereas postmortem clot, it's weakly attached to the vessel wall. It's not firmly adherent to the vessel wall. And shape is, antemortem thrombi, it doesn't take up the shape of the vessel, whereas postmortem clot, it's because of settling of the blood, so it takes the shape of the vessel or its bifurcation wherever it is formed. And microscopy, we have the lines of the Jahn very clear in this, whereas here we just see chicken fat like yellow covering on the clot, and underlying we have the deposited RBCs, underlying red currant jelly will be present. So that's the difference between antemortem and the postmortem clot. Now just a summary, what we have seen the types of the thrombi: arterial thrombi, venous thrombi, capillary and cardiac thrombi. So any of the thrombi, the fate of all the thrombi is either it undergoes the resolution, propagation, organization, or it can undergo the embolism, emboli formation. Coming to the differences between the arterial thrombi and the venous thrombi, when we see the cause or the etiology, here we have the arterial thrombi is mainly caused by the endothelial injury, which is because of the turbulence, whereas venous thrombi, the main cause is the stasis. And types of the blood flow, here it's rapidly flowing blood, whereas in the venous thrombi, it is slow flowing blood. And growth of the thrombi is in the reverse direction in the arterial thrombi, whereas in the venous thrombi, it grows in the direction of the blood flow. Sites, when we see, the most common sites are cerebral, coronary and femoral arteries, whereas the venous thrombi, they are the veins of the lower legs. This is the most common site. Then other veins are also there, but more commonly it is in the lower extremities. Lines of the Jahn, they are more prominent in the arterial thrombi, whereas less prominent in the venous thrombi. Occlusion, it is arterial thrombi, they are usually non-occlusive. Mural, whereas venous thrombi, they are usually occlusive. And effects is, as this grows, it causes ischemia and the infarction. And whereas the venous thrombi, it can detach easily and produce the emboli. So it can cause the thromboembolism.
So that finishes the types of the thrombi and about the differences between the antemortem and the postmortem clot.
Thank you, friends. Thank you for listening patiently.